There is no study yet of the memory of the Great Famine of 1933 as it existed during the Second World War. So what I'm going to say is preliminary, and it derives from my own research, mainly into the history of everyday life during the occupation of central Ukraine. I will do four things, I hope, in 20 minutes, namely to discuss two kinds of sources. First, publications that appeared under Nazi rule, and second, another kind of source, namely the recollections of visits made during the region during the Second World War. And then I will briefly discuss indirect indications of the mental legacy of the famine, again, as it existed during the war. And fourth, I will deal with a factor that complicates matters rather, namely that during the war there were more famines in Ukraine, also created deliberately, although this time by another authority. So first, my first point, publications under Nazi rule. Now, had they been really interested, the Germans could have published a lot of memoirs and diaries from the famine period. It seems that a lot of authors of these writings offered them to those who might be interested. For example, there was an Austrian named Hans Koch who writes in a wartime report, "In front of me is a diary of a woman from Kharkiv." No trace of it has been found. There is also a memoir of the famine by Oleksa Voropai, The Ninth Circle, in which he writes literally, "Many peasants had carefully put down in writing all that had occurred. These records they locked up in wooden boxes. I know of several instances during 1942 and 1943 of peasants unearthing these chronicles and offering them for publication to editors of provincial papers. But," he adds, "unfortunately, most of the editors were by now uninterested." A cursory scrutiny of the wartime Nazi-sponsored Ukrainian press shows to me, at least, that little appeared in there that focused on the famine of 1933. Most newspaper articles that mentioned the famine did so in passing, and most were not eyewitness accounts. For example, an article written in Rivne on the occasion of 25 years of Bolshevik rule appeared in various newspapers. It claimed that the entire Ukrainian press was at the moment thanking Germany and full of hatred of Bolshevism, a project of the Jews. About the past, it said various things, such as the following: "While there was a normal harvest, Ukraine ended up without grain. Trains loaded with wheat rolled and rolled to the north. The NKVD and Willis activists shook down the last bean, the last handful of corn. People were reduced to cannibalism. Only one part of the population did not feel the famine. Those were the Jews. They calmly used the services of Turksin, and they could buy their what they needed there with gold. The Jews neither lacked gold nor dollars." So here we have an example. It's a very brief mention in a litany of complaints about Bolshevism. Perhaps the main published account about the famine was not a memoir, but a fiction novel. Vlas Samchuk was a Wallonian writer and journalist who already during the famine in 1933 wrote and published Maria, the first known work of fiction about the famine. During the war, this novel helped to keep the memory of the events alive, I believe. For one thing, as he himself recalls, it was published in Rivne in 1941 and it was sold out quickly. The print run apparently was 15,000. For another, Samchuk traveled to eastern Ukraine as a journalist and on at least one occasion read from this novel in Kremenchuk. And this also occasioned an article in the local newspaper. I know of no public commemoration in German-occupied Ukraine of the famine, really, but this perhaps comes close. This is a meeting like this where somebody reads from a piece of written work. Samchuk didn't say how the people responded. Now I want to say something about recollections of wartime visits to central Ukraine, and I think I'll focus on it given the time. First to say here is that the famine of 1933 does not feature prominently in the post-war primary sources that refer to the German occupation. Hardly any memoir by a native of Central and Eastern Ukraine describes the wartime memory of that famine. For example, if you look at the large number of interviews conducted by the American Commission on the Ukraine famine, I found only one instance where the interviewer asked, was the famine of 1933 a topic for discussion during the German occupation? The respondent, Reverend Bikowitz, was adamant. Yes, and that was quite understandable. He mentioned something which he called just an example. After the Red Army had a temporary breakthrough in the spring of 1942, some people, in his words, began saying, soon our people will come, soon Nashi will come. He says there was a strong reaction. People said, what will those Reds of us bring? A new famine of 1933? Have you not had enough? The lack of sources makes the few accounts by people who, as visitors, spent time in Central and Eastern Ukraine during the war all the more important. Unfortunately, here too, few of the already limited number of accounts by visitors from Western Wallonia, Eastern Galicia, or Germany to the area mention the wartime memory of the famine. I think one reason is probably that many of these visitors simply did not take the time to listen. Or if they listened, they didn't take the time to actually write down later what they heard. For example, Mykola Klimishin, he was a member of the Northern March Group Pochitna Rupa of the Bandera faction of the OUN, Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists. He says he met already in July 41 an elderly woman near Zyahel. She turned out to be a survivor of the famine. She used the expression Tritset Proklati, but Klimishin adds, there was no time to listen to the painful truth. We hurried on. Now, those visitors' accounts that say something about the topic and that I can discuss here were written by various categories. Ukrainian nationalist activists, by one Ukrainian who was an interpreter for the Wehrmacht, by one Ukrainian who traveled as an evangelist, and finally by an Austrian German, Hans Koch, already mentioned. Almost all of these mention the famine of 1933 briefly. But, and that's, I think, significant, they often state that when they met people in East Central and Eastern Ukraine, they always mentioned the famine. And indeed, often it was the first thing they mentioned about their life. For example, Anatol Gabaida was part of a group of Melnikites, the Melnik faction of the OUN. He spent time in Kiev, and he says, literally, in Kiev, in conversations with elderly people, the topic of starvation, Holodovka, always had to be touched upon. Another Melnikite, Mikhailo Hartyremiv, describes how he spent time in a small village near Kiev in 1941. When we began a conversation with the hostess, she began to tell us about the terrible famine that she had survived. And he has a longer quotation, but I'm not going to give it. He also spent time elsewhere in Ukraine. For example, he waited for a train to embark on a trip to Kryvyi Rih. A group of other people there realized that they were from Galicia, and they began to talk about the past, about what had happened in the Dnipropetrovsk region during the famine. Bohdan Lyubomirenko was an evangelical Christian who, with others like him, moved into central Ukraine from western regions in search of like-minded people. They were firm in their belief that they would find them. He states plainly the following. The terrifying years of the artificial famine had cut deep into the memory of the people. 10 long years had been unable to erase those murderous traces. He became convinced of this because, he says, wherever we visited people, everyone in conversation could not fail to mention the days of famine they had lived through. And it was not at all uncommon if the women of the houses where we spent the night told us all night long about the horrors experienced during the artificial famine. Hans Koch, the German intelligence officer, he actually saw and heard eyewitnesses address public gatherings in the countryside about the famine. Now, a prominent element in the visitor accounts is always cannibalism. Zinovy Matla is a former commander of the Southern Group of the Bandera faction, Southern March Group. He recalled in 1952, people talked about cases of cannibalism. And unfortunately, I cannot give the surnames of the sources. Lubomirenko's group said that he heard a long story about bodies lying on the roads, and also that the godless regime reduced the people to terrible and unheard of cases of cannibalism. On his second trip, he heard similar stories. This trip began in Rivne in July 42. The voice of one woman, as he recalls, shook as she told her tale. With us, the famine began very simply. The government, Vlada, sent us the red broom, Krasnaya Metla. At her place, the government people found nothing, and angry because there was nothing to take, they poured oil in the millet and poured salt on the floor and trampled it. One night, her tale continued, a fellow Christian from a neighboring village named Ivan came begging for food. Early the next morning, this woman who told this story, she walked to the wife of this man to give them some food, but it was already too late. They were dead. And then she has a story about cannibalism. A sister, this goes as follows. The sister of the man of a house went to work in Kiev to earn something and save the children of that house. When this sister returned for a visit, the man and woman of the house decided to kill her. They did, and fed the children with this. The children saw it, they knew about it, told about it at school, and it all was a case for the militia thereafter. The woman who narrated this tale said, "That's how the Red Room changed people." As I said, there was also a Ukrainian interpreter. He said he heard horrible stories about cannibalism. Hans Koch has the same. Cases of cannibalism certainly can have taken place here. More than once I was pointed out men and women who in the villages are openly said to have eaten people. Those involved do not protest. The population considers such cases the result of extreme need without condemning them. A little bit more about the visitors. Two of the visitors who visited the former famine regions mentioned the phenomenon of resistance. One case deals with the trashing of a storage site and a lynching in the process, pogrom, of the guards. However, the source who gives this, Klimishin, the Banderite, says, "I had been looking for this kind of stories a lot of times, but only this time did I hear it." Another visitor, the former Wehrmacht interpreter who calls himself Jaroslavsky, he was interested in another aspect. It actually was just mentioned. He asked in various places if they had heard about the aid that the brothers led by the Red Cross from Western Ukraine had given to the famished peoples. No one knew about it. Actually, this matter is not at all mentioned in any of the other sources that I know. The locals in their stories, almost never in their tales to the visitors, mention what, in their opinion, caused the famine. That is a little bit strange, I think. But maybe the explanation is that few of the visitors were really interested in how the locals understood the events. I know only one case of Hulas Samchuk, who met a student and talked about the famine, and he says, specifically, as he recalls in his memoir, "Why was this famine? A bad harvest? What a bad harvest! The people were chased into a collective. Everything was taken away." Now, there are some implicit explanations of the famine in some other records, but it's only very few. A final note about the visitors. Only some record their own emotional reactions. This can be initial disbelief, in particular with the cannibalism. The evangelist Lubomirenko is not so much a disbeliever, but very angry, and he says two times in his memoirs, "I couldn't sleep." There are various indirect indications of the mental legacy of the famine. I will just go through them quickly. One is, although the evidence is not conclusive, I think that in 1941, most Ukrainian peasants welcomed the Germans and their allies as liberators. They supported without hesitation what they assumed was a war only on Stalin and his regime. One of the sources I use for this is the excellent memoir of Fedi Pihido, who describes how he can talk to Red Army soldiers who have been imprisoned, and one of them says, "We don't want to fight. They sucked our blood for 25 years. They left our children without bread to starve to death." Other sources from nationalists talk of fierce hatred of the collective farms. And they don't talk about actually something that at least one Bandera source mentions, namely that the local population hates the Russians. My final point is the complicating factor of new famine. As I recall, I have until 5:52, because I really looked at my watch, so I have 5 more minutes now. Okay, well, 2 is maybe not too bad. You see, at the same time as this is taking place, that people can actually talk about the famine, the Nazis were themselves planning more famine. I won't go into much detail. One result was an artificial famine in the city of Kiev. And in a way, this was a role reversal, because during the famine of 1933, peasants had fled to the city, and now it was the other direction and other people who were fleeing, namely city dwellers. And here the legacy of the Great Famine showed itself, if not in reality, at least in the minds of some of the people in the city. Tatiana Fisenko recalls in her memoirs, "The village was taking revenge." And then she goes on how it was during the big Great Famine. And then she says, "Now, satisfied and drunken with dreams about the return of property, the peasants were masters of the situation. So what if that woman didn't leave behind her husband's coat? In an hour, someone else would knock on the door, and with hands red from cold would unwrap things. Not without reason, the timid question of a female city dweller. 'Then what do you need?' was followed by the mocking answer, 'Barbed wire so as to fence us off from you.'" Now, none of this is based on her own personal observation, but at least the notion that the peasants were taking revenge for 1933 may indeed have been widespread. It is interesting, in my view, that to look also at the propaganda that was produced at the time. On the one hand, you have Nazi-sponsored propaganda that urges peasants not to take advantage of the situation. And there are indeed posters and newspaper articles that say, "Peasants, you must also provide food for your brothers in the cities." On the second hand, you have Soviet propaganda, of course not formally available in the region, but that did mention the famine in Kiev and other cities controlled by the Germans. Quite specifically, often actually, that was rather surprising to me. Here I would like to add the note that it's strange that this could happen during the war, whereas after the war in Soviet public culture, there is a total ignorance of this famine in Kiev for reasons that I'm not quite sure of. So, to conclude. In central and eastern Ukraine during the German occupation, the Great Famine seems to have been the by far most talked about historical event for quite some time. At last, the people could get the horrors that they had seen off their chest, and they told visitors whom they encountered all about it. Oleksa Voropai was probably right to state in his memoir that the famine has driven such deep furrows into the memory of our nation that volumes of horror stories could be collected about it. The peasants show an extraordinary vivid memory when recalling the events. They do not forget the names of those who died from starvation. They remember the exact number of victims, the names of the activists who confiscated everything, and all the details. It's another matter, so you have a vivid memory. It's another matter what exactly was their interpretation? You have to divide here, and that's my final note, between various generations. Young people knew there had been this famine, but I call it the Komsomol generation because this generation, by and large, believed in the basic tenets of the system they had lived under. This famine had not shaken their faith. What other people thought about the famine, though the older people, is quite hard to subtract from the sources. You find accusations of the authorities, and that's it. And there's nothing more specific. So that really requires more study. Thank you for your attention.